Today's video is going to be on these forever foods, a small but distinct collection of foods that, if properly stored, can be passed down through the generations. And towards the end of this video, so stick around towards the end, after I get through this list, we're going to talk about ways of storing a lot of products. And that's what's coming up next on Survival Preparedness for Beginners. Hey there, folks. Let's set ourselves up for a little storyline here. Picture yourself. Things have gone bad. Things have got really bad. You're searching out food and stuff. You have found an abandoned house. Nobody's living there anymore. So you go in, you're looking for supplies. You're looking for anything. You're hungry. You go down in the basement and you find food that's been packed away down there from 1981. The stuff is dated. Can you eat it? It's been down there for 30 years. It can't possibly still be good, right? Can it? Yes, it can. The scene has been set. You have found the food. Back in 1859, a man named Darwin made a great statement. Now, I'm not a fan of Darwin. I like a couple of his quotes. I don't agree with his theology on certain topics that we're not going to mention, because this video is about some foods that will survive forever. Darwin said, "It's not the strongest of the species that survives, nor is it the most intelligent that survives. It is the one that is most adaptable to change that will survive." Darwin also said, and back in 1869, in the fifth edition of his book that he wrote, "The Survival of the Fittest." Now, actually, if you really want to get down to terms, he did not come up with that phrase. A man named Herbert Spencer came up with the phrase. Darwin used it in the fifth edition of the book that he published in 1869. Now, moving on to a little bit of this history of foods that will survive, that can stand the test of time, that could be passed down through generations. There's nothing really magical about how food spoils. I mean, really, if you think about it. Simply put, something else is eating it before you get to eat it because of what is going on inside the food and the way that it is stored. And these things are called microbes. In the form of yeast, mold, and bacteria, unpopular food storage is the leading cause of spoilage in all your foods. Now, the three things that break down the foods are yeast, mold, and bacteria. We all know that. If you have something in the refrigerator, let's take cheese for an instance. Cheese breaks down, gets mold on it, and everything else. With cheese, you can cut the mold off and still eat the cheese that's inside that doesn't have the mold on it. You know, it's just a way that they do age cheese. Now, something to remember, all right? A lot of people think about best if used by. Now, this is a big thing for a lot of people. A lot of people have a problem with using foods with that best if used by date. The longer a food is stored, the more likely the flavor, nutritional value, and the health benefits decline. That's a proven scientific fact, and any prepper will tell you that. This is all dependent partly on how it was packaged, when it was originally stored, and partly on how it spent its time wandering through the years in your pantry root cellar or in your, say, basement. The best way is freeze-dried, dehydrated, and vacuum-sealed foods that are the best ways to store foods for long term. But there are four things that is the number one killer, and I call it MOLT. What does MOLT stand for, folks? MOLT stands for moisture, oxygen, light, and temperature. That's why you hear a lot of preppers all state to store in a cool, dry, dark place. Because then you're covering MOLT. MOLT is a good word to remember when storing your foods. All right, you got to keep the moisture out. You got to keep the oxygen out. You got to keep it away from light. And you got to try to keep it in a temperature controlled environment. And those are the primary factors in how long your food's going to last in your pantry. What are some of the foods? Some of the foods, and not all of them, are actually foods. And these are in no particular order, folks. Okay? So today, it's just going to be top 10 items that are going to be able to withstand resistance and last a lifetime that you could pass down throughout the generations of your family. Number one, bouillon cubes. Bouillon cubes could be used in a lot of different ways. I mean, they last forever. And you can use them to season stuff. If you want to just make chicken broth, if somebody was sick, you can get chicken and beef and vegetable and all these different kinds. And they're going to last for a very long time to help put flavor into whatever it is that you may have to cook if something bad does happen and things go south. Number two, baking soda. If you even look on the carton of an Arm & Hammer baking soda product, it has over 100 uses. You can use baking soda in cooking. You can use it to clean. You can use it to clean the terminals on your batteries and get the acid off. It has so many uses that you probably could write a small book on just baking soda. But it will last forever if stored properly. Number three, hard alcohol. Now we're talking your vodkas, your scotches, your bourbons, your whiskeys, all that kind of stuff. If you store it properly, that stuff's going to last forever. And that would be one of a great bartering tool to have in a bad situation. Now, I use the word bad situation to avoid any problems in doing this video. Number four is honey. Everybody knows about honey. Honey's been around for hundreds of thousands of years, all the way back to the pyramid time, the great pharaohs, and all that kind of stuff. They have found honey in some of these tombs and stuff that they determined was still edible to this day. So honey is something that you can use in a lot of different ways. You can treat sunburn with honey. You can treat different wounds with honey, different skin irritations. Not to mention, you can add it to a lot of foods and stuff if you don't have like sugars and these type of things. Honey is one of the most precious commodities and products that we can have in our arsenals for when things go bad. Salt is another one. Number five. Salt is a very, very good thing to have. You can preserve a lot of food. You can do a lot of different things with salt. If you had to, if say you've been in your boots and you've been walking for miles and you finally have or you got back to your camp, or you got back to your house, you've been out scouting, or whatever else. You know, you can always put your feet in a salt bath and it'll help relax your feet, heal your feet, and everything else. Salt has so many different things that it can cover and do. So that's why it's on this list. Sugar is another one. Sugar, once sugar is packed properly and it's stored away, sugar is going to last you for a very long time. And you always need sugar for a lot of different products, a lot of different cooking, and all these different things. So having sugar is a great thing to have. Now remember, none of this stuff is in any particular order, okay? Number 7 is rice. Now we all know about rice. If you're a prepper, you know about rice. You know how to store the rice, and you know how to make that rice last as long as possible. And number 8, everybody's favorite, that would be instant coffee or even instant cocoa. If you store those things due properly, instant coffee is freeze-dried. It will last forever, just like if you bought freeze-dried meals from any of your favorite freeze-dried companies. The hot cocoa, I would suggest you probably want to make sure that you vacuum pack those things and everything else. So maybe somewhere down the road you could have a cup of hot cocoa. Something a little different, a little bit of chocolate flavor, probably would go a long way in a bad situation, if you know what I'm saying. Number 9, powdered milk. Now, dried powdered milk is the best. The instant dried powdered milk won't last as long as regular dried powdered milk. So remember that when you're putting up your dry powdered milk, that's the one you want, and that, if you store it properly, will last for a very long time. And number 10 is dried beans. Now, dried beans, you have to make sure that you know what you're doing. There are certain beans that you have to make sure that you rinse, you soak, and rinse off all the residue and everything else, because some of those can make you sick if you do not know how to do them properly. That's why I suggest that when you are putting away your products, if you're not sure and you know exactly, you have a memory that how to do those things, put the instructions in the bag with whatever it is you're storing. I would suggest that with anything that you plan on putting away, especially if you're vacuum sealing Mylar bags or anything of that nature. This way here, you always have it with you. Or you could always tape it to the outside of the bag. Your choice. It doesn't really matter. It's not going to affect anything if you put it inside the bag. Now, conclusion here, folks. When you're storing a lot of your different products, you have several different options out there. Now, a lot of people ask me, you know, what is the best vacuum sealer, the cheapest, best vacuum sealer? Now, I wouldn't suggest going cheap. This is where I talk about in several of my videos that you need to make sure that you are buying good quality products that you're going to be putting up your food that you just spent your hard-earned money on. You want to make sure you have the best that you can afford. So my suggestion, you want to make sure that you're going with good quality products whenever you are doing canning, vacuum sealing, Mylar bags, canning jars, all this different type of stuff. Don't go cheap, because you're trying to put stuff away that's going to last you for a very long time. When you're vacuum sealing, you can always use an oxygen absorber and throw it in there for extra security. There's nothing wrong with that. If you don't, it's not really going to make much of a difference as long as you are storing these products properly. If you're using Mylar bags, Well, Mylar bags have a lot of different benefits. Unlike the vacuum sealed bags, the vacuum sealed bags are not light friendly, meaning it's clear plastic light can get through it. Mylar bags, on the other hand, are not clear. They're silver and they reflect the light. See where I'm going here? Inside your Mylar bags, you're probably going to want to use oxygen absorbers, and depending on what you're putting in there, you could also use the silica packs, which the silica packs actually pull the moisture out and the oxygen absorbers pull the oxygen out. So if you're not really too sure if things are totally 100% dry before you're packing them, you may want to throw in a silica pack just on the chance that you need it to make sure that the moisture is out. If there's still moisture in the bag, in the product that you have put in there, even a small, minute particles of moisture, that can start to grow. And the next thing you know, 10 years later, you open it up and you got a bag full of fuzz that looks like cotton candy. But you're not going to want to eat it. Canning jars. Canning jars are a great way to can. The downfall is they're clear. Light gets to them, so you have to have a dark place to store these products in a controlled temperature environment. Remember the word MOLT. Moisture, oxygen, light, and temperature are the four different ingredients into ruining your food that you have put up. So if you're going to be doing canning and stuff, make sure that you have at least a closet or something that you can stack this stuff in. Make sure if you have a basement, great, put them in the basement where it's dark and cool. If you have a root cellar, even better, you can keep them to store them down in there. Never store any of your products in the garage if you live in a very hot climate. And you also still have to be careful, even if you live in the north during the summertime, because the temperatures warm up, so your garage is probably going to warm up, and you want to make sure that you are monitoring the situation that is taking place in those areas. Remember MOLT. Now, when you are canning and doing all that kind of stuff, you can actually vacuum seal. You can pressure can. You can water bath. You make sure that all the products are going to last. So you can actually use oxygen absorbers, and you can also use silica packs. Say you're dehydrating vegetables. Perfect example here. You're dehydrating all your vegetables and everything else, and you want to make sure that they're going to last for a very long time. Here's my suggestion. I would get a large canning jar that you can vacuum seal. Inside that canning jar, I would include an oxygen absorber and a silica pack. For the simple reason is, even after you vacuum seal it, any oxygen that could be left in any of the cracks and crannies and everything else that's in those products, the oxygen absorber is going to pull that out. Any moisture, if you did not get all the pieces dry and say you missed them because you need to check your products before you put them into your canning jars, make sure that they are dry. But if you did miss some, if you put the oxygen absorber and the silica pack in there, with the silica pack, it's going to draw out any moisture that was left to preserve the whole can jar that you just vacuum sealed of all your dehydrated products. Because all it takes, folks, is for a few pieces to still be moist, and the next thing you know, it could ruin the whole can. And you don't want that. The whole key is MOLT. You want to stay away from moisture, oxygen, light, and temperature. Those are the main things that are your enemies in storing your food, in storing what you have worked so hard for, and all the time that you put in prepping a lot of these things. There's a lot of prep that goes into all these different products and the way that you have to do them. I have several videos and several playlists on my channel that you can go back and you can watch. I do dehydration, dehydrate, how I store my rice, how to do a lot of different things on this channel. And if you have questions, please leave in the comments below. And if I don't have the answer, I'll try to do the research and find it for you. I'm working on one right now on a gentleman that lives in the Caribbean, and he is having difficult times in storing food long term because of MOLT. Light, moisture, oxygen, and temperature. And he asked me if I could help him out. And I am in the process of doing a lot of different research for this gentleman to try to come up with some answers to where possibly maybe he can preserve his food. He's have issues with things going bad. I believe that there's ways around every situation. We just have to figure them out. And that's why I started this channel. There's a lot of beginners that are out there that are on this channel that are learning. They have questions. I try to answer them. And the community is really great about pitching in and helping people out. And I greatly appreciate that, because that's what we're here for, folks. We have to stick together. The survival of the fittest survive. If you're willing to adapt and make changes to your lifestyle, you will survive. So I am Survival Preparedness for Beginners. I'd like to thank everybody for joining me on this video today. Thank you very much for all you do for my channel, for all the likes. Share this video with all your friends and family. That helps me out the most. But your likes and your comments and everything else, I greatly appreciate. And I greatly appreciate you being here today. So until next time, folks, I will catch all of you on the flip side. Stay safe, thrive to survive.